engineering team at SDSC, which is the Science and Technology Facilities Council, where we do technical workshops. Well, I'm actually going to tell you a little bit about diversity as a form of impact. And I was the diversity chair for the RSE conference, which happened last week, so this is part of the press. RSE is a research software engineers. This was the very first conference ever. So, the aim of the conference organising committee was that the attendees in the conference committee and the speakers reflected the population of software engineers, research software engineers. We started off thinking it was going to be a UK conference, but we ended up with people from Canada, New Zealand, mainland Europe, speaking lots of people from the States because it was co-located, so it was a sort of, our population was maybe a bit wider than we thought. Because it's computing, when we think diversity, we tend to think gender and ethnicity rather than any other forms of gender. In the UK, our Equalities Act makes it illegal to discriminate on all these different types of characteristics: age, pregnant, disability, race, religion, lack of religion. But that we were really just interested in age, gender, and ethnicity. So how did I get this job? This is a slide I added in this morning. I'm sure I was a little bit up. So I volunteered because I'm interested in gender, because I've been a woman in computing for all my career, although I did a bit in libraries, and on the whole, I've always been in the minority, apart from where I worked in the library when I was in the majority, so it's something I'm interested in. But the main reason I got it was because I was at a collaboration workshop, and over dinner, I was telling Rob Haynes, who ran the conference, about my experience of bias. So I just thought I'd tell this experience. I think it's quite interesting. So in the UK, one of our national radio stations runs a short story competition for children, where the first level is judged by librarians and teachers, and I am one of those judges. And I'm also a governor at my local primary school. When I told them that, they ran a competition for short story for the whole school and asked me if I'd judge it. So there I am, judging the school. So primary school, age 5 to 11. I get to, starting at the bottom, I get to year 9 and realise that everyone I've picked out is a boy. Right? Short story competition, at that age group, girls are much better at writing than boys. So I suddenly thought, hang on a sec, and realised that I have a son, I'm a woman in computing, it was an open subject, I'm not really interested in unicorns and fairies. And it was very gender. Do you know what I mean? And I was biasing whether I liked the story too much by whether I liked the actual content of the story. And I then went re-back, having noticed this, I went back and re-judged it and ended up with a different result. So I think unconscious bias is a really fascinating topic. And what did we do? So we made a diversity statement, we had a code of conduct, based on the PyCon statement. So hopefully they were setting expectations of what we wanted, being inclusive. We ensured our diversity was consideration in areas under our control. So our keynote speakers ensured that they were to the point, but also that we considered diversity and reviewed the panel. We had a bit of a discussion about things we thought might put people off, which I thought was a real gender issue, but turned out to be a general concern. I never like in strange towns getting to conference dinners on my own in the dark. I'm really paranoid about it. Turned out that one of the other members of the committee, Mr. Chat, was also paranoid about it. So we did some work around buddying up. I don't know how successful that's been, because the conference was only last week. I've done some stats, which I'll show in the next slide. And I contacted other diversity chairs to see if I could do some best practice sharing, because the thing is, there weren't very many people who submitted stuff, so I could make statistics, but I didn't know whether they were valid, because there weren't enough. The other thing was, I said I'd be diversity chair if I wasn't the only woman on the committee. I hate the show, which I haven't put on here, is that if you were a woman and you submitted a talk, you were much, much, much more likely to get submitted, get accepted than men. But there is such a handful, I'm not sure if it's true. But that leads on to the discussion I had earlier about women tend to be even more confident if they put themselves forward than men, so tend to be more successful. Attendees, we had a SSI form, so we asked their gender, their age, and ethnicity. The age turned out to be completely useless because obviously had a bit of sleep, and we asked for such wide age bands. As Simon Hetrick said, we could tell whether you're a student, whether you're working, or whether you're retired. So I haven't done enough of that. We had quite an interesting discussion about whether these demographic questions ought to be compulsory, whether I prefer not to say option, or to have it optional. So the consensus was to have it non-compulsory. So I've got answers that both someone's typed in prefer not to say, and some people haven't answered it. I'm quite interested in thoughts about how compulsory you have to make these questions. So the outcome was on gender representation was better than the general computing population, but the ethnicity wasn't, should be looking further. So this one shows you 72% of the people overall were men, 16% were women, and the rest preferred not to say themselves. And this shows you that practically one is right. Need those. But this diversity is something that the new chairs of the network are quite interested in. And so I suppose what I'm saying is that diversity isn't a sort of impact of the workshops, but it's not necessarily the you need to. I think it's important to know that the population you're drawing from is representative. The population intended